And we're recording. Okay, does anybody have any questions from yesterday with regard to anything that we spoke about? How are you with your medical terminology so far? Okay? You ready to learn some more medical terminology? Mm-hmm. Can we add 10 more words to our repertoire of medical terminology now? Because this is a 8 certification class. And you're not only doing medical assistant, you're doing phlebotomy, you're doing patient care, clinical lab, you're doing IV, telemetry. There's lots of terminology, but the terminology that we learn, it crosses all over the medical field. So there's not technically one specific terminology for phlebotomy or one specific terminology for medical assistance. Medical terminology is medical terminology, okay? So let's add some more words to our repertoire. Next word is venipuncture, V-E-N-I-P-U-N-C-T-U-R-E. And venipuncture is, who would like to tell me? Yes?
Drawing blood.
Drawing blood, yeah. Look at it this way, vein puncture. So basically you're puncturing the vein, right? With a vacutainer needle, hopefully. So this just means drawing blood. Drawing blood. Okay, so that's one. Hemolysis. Hemolysis. There's two words here, and if you can see, medical terminology is really kind of, it's easy once you get to know it because it makes sense as opposed to the English language when you try to spell certain words and you just have to memorize what it means. Yes, yeah, Cindy.
A little cup busted and it looked like it was spilled in the microwave.
You
have something to clean it up with?
Yeah, there's some paper towel behind that AMCA. Grab it. Your cup busted?
Yeah.
Dear Lord. Okay. Wheel. Hemolysis. Look at the words. Hemo and lysis. Hemo, like hematology, blood. So under hemo, we're going to put blood. And to lyse is to separate. So S-E-P-A-R-A-T, separate. So the separation of blood, hemolysis. Now you're going to find that hemolysis takes place if you take a tube of blood, which I actually have some here, but let's say you take a tube and you've just drawn blood, and instead of inverting it nice and easy and slow, you do this, like you're making a martini. Okay, when you do that, what you've actually done is you've ruptured all the red blood cells. And all of the contents of the red blood cells, because red blood cells are fat, they're happy, they're filled with all kinds of nutrients and things, and analytes. So when those blood cells rupture, they taint the serum a reddish color. And serum, we're going to look at that, and I'm probably not today, but this color right here, this amber-like fluid, is what we call serum. And it's very interesting because in serum, what we're going to learn, there are no clotting factors in serum. By virtue of the fact that serum separator tubes, when you centrifuge them, fractionate according to the density of the different components of blood. But this serum's a nice kind of lit, clear amber. If I were to shake this vigorously, that amber would turn red. And I would have hemolyzed the blood cells, and they would have ruptured and spilled out into the serum. So hemolysis, or hemolysis, it's an easy way of thinking blood separation, okay? Any questions on these two? Okay, let's take a look at another word that pertains to phlebotomy. Ischemia. And this is not just to phlebotomy, it applies across the board because ischemia can occur in many different scenarios. We pronounce this ischemia. Can you say that with me, everybody?
Ischemia.
Ischemia, exactly. What does it mean? It means cutting off oxygen to the tissues. So depriving tissues of oxygen. How can this happen? Well, there's lots of ways. If you leave a rubber band on your arm too long, or a tourniquet on too long, what will happen is eventually it'll cause the tissue an environment that's ischemic, and the tissues will die and they will become necrotic, which is our next word. But ischemia just means depriving tissues of oxygen, which is really bad, very, very, very bad, because we can never keep tourniquets on more than 60 seconds. And that's the biggest rule of phlebotomy. Do not keep your tourniquets on more than 60 seconds. And we'll go over that a little bit later. So ischemia. A person that has a heart attack can have ischemia of the heart due to a blocked artery, right? Mm-hmm. So somebody may have an artery that's blocked, blood flow can't get to the heart, and then what happens is that tissue in the heart is deprived of oxygen, and they have a heart attack, right? They have a myocardial infarction. That's our next word. Myocardial infarction and necrosis. So if the heart is cut off from oxygen, somebody's going to start to sweat. They may have pain in their left arm. They may have pain radiating in their jaw. They may have pain between their shoulder blades. They may feel nauseous. Something doesn't feel right. They may start sweating. They'll get real pale. They may feel like they're going to have diarrhea or very loose bowels. Doesn't necessarily mean they're going to be short of breath. A lot of times people can have a heart attack while they're driving a car, painting their house, jogging. Sometimes they don't even know it until they actually do an EKG, or they go into a hospital and they do a cardiac enzyme profile, or they do a catheterization. So ischemia can take place in a lot of different scenarios. It just means tissue being deprived of oxygen. Necrosis is dead tissue. So as ischemia takes place, now necrosis will take place. Necrosis is dead tissue, necrotic tissue. If you've ever seen anybody that has had a bed sore, which you will when you go to clinicals, unfortunately, people with bed sores or decubitus ulcers, another word, D-E-C-U, decubitus ulcers, this is a where people are sitting all day, or they're incontinent. There's another word, incontinent. Incontinent of urine and or stool, which means they can't hold their bladder or bowel, and they wear a brief. We don't call them diapers, we call them briefs. And maybe they can't walk. So they have moisture, and if they have to, we have to move them, they have shear against their skin. Eventually what happens if they're not taken care of, that moisture and shear will start to wear away the first epidermal layer. When that happens and that's left untreated, sometimes it'll scab over and it'll start to, the tissue underneath deprived of oxygen because of the scab. The scab doesn't always necessarily mean it's healing. The tissue underneath will start to die and become filled with purulent drainage, dead skin, pus, it'll turn green, it'll smell really, really bad. Mm-hmm. And when the scab turns black, black is necrotic. When you have black tissue, black is the knob on the centrifuge machine, that's a very ominous sign. Patients that have decubitus ulcers that have become necrotic, a lot of times they have to go into surgery and debride them. So we debride the ulcers. They debride the ulcer, they put the patient to sleep, or they numb them. Most of the time I think they give them a sedative, and they have to go in and scrape out all the bad tissue. And then they have to leave the wound open to heal. And if the wound is open and healing, then we want serosanguinous drainage. Serosanguinous drainage from the tissue means blood and tissue fluid. If you see blood and tissue fluid in a deep wound, that's a good sign. If you take the dressing off of a wound that's been dressed and it's red and maybe just a little bit of yellow from the tissue fluid, that's a really good sign. That means the capillaries have been broken in the different layers of the epidermis, and they're bleeding through. And as they bleed through, they heal the other tissues, because blood carries oxygen. So a certain amount of bleeding in certain deep tissue wounds is a good thing.
Is debride one of the medical terminology?
Yes, debride.
Okay.
I'm going to put debridement. Don't know if there's an either. I'm
okay,
dyslexic
so,
and a
so
terrible.
Kind of lost after the encounter.
It's okay. I'm going to go through them. I'm going to go through them one at a time.
Confused.
Don't be confused. No. What I'm going to do is, as I'm talking, I'm writing some of our words down. Then we're going to go through each and every one of them.
Oh,
and we'll
oh,
label
okay.
them. Okay. Answer your call. We'll be fine. Breathe. It's okay. So let's come back. We know what dead tissue is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Myocardial infarction. That's a heart attack, isn't it?
Yep.
That is a heart attack. Now, when we do CPR in this class through the American Heart Association, we're doing our 2-year basic life support for healthcare providers. And there's a difference between a heart attack and a cardiac arrest. What do you think the difference is? Heart attack, cardiac arrest.
A heart attack, you're having like an actual... cardiac arrest means that your heart has stopped.
It has stopped.
Yeah.
We have an emergency situation. The heart has stopped. We have to start it as healthcare providers, right?
Yeah.
By doing what? Cardiopulmonary resuscitation, right? So a heart attack or MI, a lot of times you know this word, everybody, MI. Patient admitted, 54-year-old male with complaint of chest pain, nausea, vomiting, you know, blood pressure 190 over 105, tachypnea, rapid respiration. Write tachypnea down. I'm just going to write some words down and go over them. He's breathing really fast. Not hyperventilating, but he's breathing fast. He's very diaphoretic. Diaphoretic, he's sweating. So myocardial infarction, those are a lot of the signs and symptoms. You'll need to know that, because as a medical assistant, if you're working in a doctor's office, my mom actually had her heart attack in a doctor's office. She went to see her doctor, and then boom, she had a myocardial infarction. They could see it when they hooked her up to the EKG machine. So you need to know signs and symptoms of this, right?
So how long did her heart stop?
It didn't stop. She had a heart attack. It's a difference. A myocardial infarction means there's a blockage of some kind, and it causes ischemia to the heart. And so when the heart becomes ischemic, it tightens up because there's tissue there that doesn't have oxygen, and it causes you to feel that pain or angina. And they took her to Oakwood. And then a doctor, they were going to release her. They had her on nitroglycerin and nitro patches. And then the cardiologist came in and said, you know, let's do a cardiac catheterization. And they found that she had blockage 90% in three of her vessels. And then they took her over to St. John's, where she had to have a triple bypass, which we call a CABBAGE. It's a coronary arterial bypass graft. Coronary arterial bypass graft. And a lot of times we call them CABBAGE. C-A-B-G. Okay, so myocardial infarction. We talked about decubitus ulcers. These are pressure sores. A lot of times you'll know decubitus ulcers by another term called pressure sores. It's important that you know how these are formed and how, why and how they occur. Lack of movement, right? Incontinence. Incontinence means inability to hold, inability to control bladder or bowel. So if someone can't control their bladder or bowel, well then we have to toilet them on a regular schedule so that they don't have to sit or have an accident while they're sitting. Because people that sit in wheelchairs all day, let me tell you what, you can take them for maybe a half an hour, but a lot of these elderly people, they're in them all day. They wake them up at 5 o'clock, they toilet them a few times a day, they get them ready for bed around 8. That's a long time to be sitting in a vinyl or just a chair that isn't very comfortable. They try to put pads and pillows, but still, it's not the same as sitting in your own home. It's not the same as sitting on your couch. So, and a lot of times these people, they're either afraid or they don't feel that they can ask for help. You know, I need something softer to sit on. And a lot of times if people don't complain, the nurses' aides, even the nurses, don't bother to ask them. Oh, they're sitting in front of the TV, they're watching Al Roker, they're watching the Weather Channel from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. It's like, really? Maybe they want to watch Turner Classic Movies. You know, maybe they want to watch Gene Kelly.
So they don't like participate in some kind of clubs or any programs that they have for them?
There are, that's a really good point. There are occupational therapy, recreational therapy, a lot of convalescent homes or extended care facilities have them. The problem is when people reach a certain age and they have real bad immobility issues. They can't get up, they can't stand up, they have to go to the bathroom every 2 hours. And they still have their faculties about them. Unfortunately, if they're not in their home and they're in this foreign place, they never really feel like it's their home. And a lot of times they're afraid to participate because they're afraid they're going to make somebody mad and then that person won't take care of them.
Oh.
One of the nurse's aides may have an attitude. Well, if I want to participate in, recreational therapy, you know, I may have to go to the bathroom and I may have to ask my nurse's aide and she may get mad at me and say, well, what do you want? Well, that's abuse. Mm-hmm. But you don't want to know how often that takes place. And a lot of these people that get hired in these places don't even think about it, how they're affecting these elderly people.
They're making them sicker.
They are making them sicker. When I was a nurse's aide many moons ago, I was looking for a job. I just wanted to work. I didn't want to go to college. I just wanted to work. I told my dad, just take me about, let me find a job. And I was knocking on doors. And I knocked on this one door, which was a convalescent home, and they just basically just grabbed me and pulled me in. And they said, good, somebody wants to work. Let's put her to work. Okay, what do you want me to do? And I'll tell you what, that 1 year that I spent there changed my whole life.
Wow.
Changed my whole life for the better. Because these people that I met were the most caring, the most gentle. I saw a side of humanity that you know, it broke my heart because I saw how some of the other aides took care of these people. Actually, there was one lady in there that was paying a nurse's aide who would go out on her lunch break and chug a fifth. I watched, saw her in the car. She would pay this nurse's, a little lady would pay this nurse's aide, so she knew she would have good care because this nurse's aide had some bad attitude. So she figured if she paid her, it's kind of like gang money. It's like, you know, here's money. But don't treat me bad.
Oh my God.
And I mean, what people were able to, I still remember the names of the people that I worked with that have since passed away. And, you know, they'll live on. I mean, I can see them, I mean, I can't see them, but I mean, I can see them in my mind as if, you know, they were, it was yesterday. They made such a mark on me, such an indelible mark. One of the gentlemen, he used to write poetry about aging, and he used to show it to me. There was a, when I got hired at Oakwood, it was a big step up. After a year in the convalescent home, I got hired at Oakwood as a nurse's aide. I bought him a mosaic cross for Christmas because I wanted to give him a going away present because I missed all these people. We used to talk with them and we used to laugh and we used to have conversations with everybody.
It's like family.
They were family. Well, you'd spend 8 hours a day caring for them, doing everything they needed. And toward the end, before I left, my last day, I know that he was in the recreational therapy room just working on that mosaic. He had bandages because they were the little stones that you'd put, you know, and his fingers were all bandaged because he was putting those little stones, you know, on the cross. And then I wanted to go say goodbye to him, and he presented me with a gift. He made the cross and he gave it back to me. And I'll never forget that. I had it for the longest time. You know, these people made just, and then now I see my mom getting up in years. You know, she told me the other night, she says, you know, Nancy, I was getting her ready for bed, and she says, you know, Nancy, she's 93. She says, when I get older, she says, nobody's going to take care of me but you. I said, okay, Mom, you got it. You got it. I'll be here, you know, as long as the good Lord tells me I can, till I go.
Bless your heart.
But, well, thanks. But, you know, these people, they need that emotional content in everyday living. It's not, okay, Mrs. Smith, you said you need a glass of water. Here, go. Okay, well, maybe Mrs. Smith needs more than a glass of water, you know? Maybe she's dehydrated. Maybe she could use an Ensure shake on ice. Maybe she could use some peanut butter crackers. I'm going to teach you in this class how important nutrition is. Because these people in these extended care facilities, where you won't work because medical assistants don't work there, but you need to get experience there, these people won't ask for food. They're not going to ask you, you know, can you go to Miller's Bar and I need one of those huge hamburgers, you know, and you know, or get me a slush, or get me something, you know. They're used to the eating a certain way. Now they're spending the rest of their life in a room with a roommate who may or may not have Alzheimer's and be talking all night. In a room where most people just come and go as they please without knocking. In a facility where there's breakfast, lunch, and dinner. If you're lucky, there's a snack. I'm talking about even some of the high-end places where you really don't have much of a choice between breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It's either this on Monday, this on Wednesday, this on Thursday, every week, 365 days a year. That sounds like prison to me. I'm sorry. You know, all they're missing is a weight room and a smoking area, which I think they have. And now they're even harder on residents now. Well, you can't smoke. It's like, really? You're going to tell somebody who's 85 years old and has a stogie every so often that he can't smoke because it's against the rules? They're taking all their Social Security money, pocketing it, where these people don't have a dime There's no magic bank account that they can go outside and scan an ATM. A lot of times, due to their immobility, that's where they're at. And the saddest thing is, you don't see any family. The saddest thing for me was when Christmas would come. And there'd be nobody. These people, some of them, I'm sorry.
We can take a break, it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay, we're gonna get through this and then we'll take a break. Some people, they wouldn't have clothes. We would have to go to the laundry room and we would have to get clothes that people had donated to put them on. And here it was Christmas. And not one person would come in to see these people. So what are your kids? You don't ask that question, of course, but you're thinking, hello? Don't you have a daughter or a son? Some people didn't actually have children, so I understood that, but no family. And so it was an eye-opening. And I decided that if I have to be in this field, and this is my field, so wherever and whomever I care for, I'm going to take care of them like they're my family until I clock out, whether they're in the hospital or a convalescent home. And all the other people that, you know, if they're part of your assignment for the day, you have to try to tend to their needs. And it seems overwhelming because a lot of times convalescent homes will give you more work than what you can handle. They try to put a lot on the nurse's aides, a lot, and it's really hard and it becomes very overwhelming. And there's something in this field that we're gonna learn about, it's called caregiver stress. You know, it's caregiver stress and it happens. And so when people have these nurses' aides, I don't know how they become nurses' aides, but if you are having problems at home, a lot of times they don't leave them at home. They bring them to work. And the people that, unfortunately, they take it out on sometimes are the patients, which is not right. So, with that being said, let's keep on going. So we understand about decubitus ulcers. We understand what debridement is. This is what? This is cleaning. It's more than cleaning. It's actually excoriate. Debridement is a surgical, well, it doesn't have to be surgical. Just let's put down removing the dead skin. Removing dead tissue. Dead tissue can be a surgical suite, or it may be a wet to dry dressing that the doctor orders. To wet to dry means it's wet, it's wet and then it's dry, and then the water absorbs and pulls up the skin, the dead skin. So when you take it off, it can be rather painful, but there's a way to do that. You can pull off the dead skin. Every day you change it. Okay, so let's take a look how many words we have. 1, 2, 3, 12. We have more than 10.
22. Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, I think it's fine. I'm not going to take any away. So let's just go ahead and just go through and define them. Okay, so incontinent. If someone is incontinent of bladder and bowel, what does it mean?
They cannot hold their stool.
They cannot. That is correct, Sue. So, how can we help these people? That will probably give them some type of barrier protection or briefs to wear and toilet them
on a regular schedule.
Okay. Venipuncture means what?
Drawing blood.
Hemolysis.
Separation of blood.
Ischemia.
Depriving tissue of oxygen.
Good. Necrosis.
Dead tissue.
Yep. Myocardial infarction.
Heart attack.
Decubitus ulcers.
Pressure sores. Dreadful lack of movement.
Good. Debridement.
Cleaning and removing of dead tissue.
Good. Serosanguinous drainage. Let's say this together because look at this. It's one sero. Sanguinous. Okay, let's say it. Serosanguinous drainage. Yes. Is this good drainage?
Yes.
It is, right? It's kind of a bloody, watery fluid. That's healthy drainage, serosanguinous drainage.
Good drainage.
Okay, it's healthy. This is healthy. This is a healthy wound drainage.
Oh, so this is usually happens to the wound.
Yes, serosanguinous drainage occurs at wounds. Like if someone's a post-op surgery, and let's say they've had an appendectomy or a cholecystectomy, which is a gallbladder removal, and they have staples, sometimes the staples may drain, and that drainage should be kind of a reddish, fluidy, water, blood and water type drainage, and that's good. What's not good? Tell me some colors that are not good.
Black, green.
Black and green, okay. We definitely don't want black drainage, green drainage. What's another color?
Yellow.
Yeah, yellow, right? I mean like bright pussy yellow. Pussy yellow mixed with green. Did anyone have breakfast yet?
No.
Welcome to the health world. We can sit and talk about all kinds of things and enjoy our breakfast, you know? So tell me about that wound. What color was it? Okay, while we're pouring syrup on our pancakes. Okay, so serosanguinous drainage, let's move over here. Tachypnea. Tachypnea is a fast breathing. And how fast? Well, typically normal respiration is anywhere between 12 to 20, you said 22. I'd say anything higher than like 23 breaths per minute. So anything greater than 23 breaths per minute is considered tachypnea. Tachypnea can be normal in certain cases. When do you have tachypnea?
When you're hyperventilating.
Okay, or you're running, you're jogging, you're exercising. When would tachypnea not be, would be out of place?
At rest.
At rest, right? You're breathing fast while you're resting. Ah, something's not right. You've got to learn that, to get that gut feeling when something's not right. That's part of the in nursing, they tell us, which, you know, as somebody who teaches the sciences and, you know, engineering and physics and math, when I studied nursing, a lot of the nurses would say, go with your gut. They'd say the spidey sense. Like, well, how scientific is this? Let me tell you what. Human interaction and empathy and understanding what your patient, you know, is going through, when you notice something that's out of the ordinary, that's a spidey sense. And you need to look at that. You can't ignore it. If somebody's breathing 30 respirations a minute, and it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and they should be resting, because our breaths per minute go down dramatically while we're sleeping, right? Then there's a problem that you have to notify somebody about. Okay, what did I say? You remember what I said diaphoretic means?
Sweating.
Sweating. Yeah, that's a fancy word. So next time you go to the gym, you want to wow your friends, and you're just wiping the sweat off your brow, say, I'm so diaphoretic. I'm just so, what'd you say? I'm diaphoretic. Okay, coronary arterial bypass graft, or CABG. That's the surgery, right? That's your bypass surgery. Triple, quadruple, double. This is considered your bypass surgery. Bypass surgery means what? That they've cut open the chest opened the chest cavity, and anastomosed, took out the vein that was blocked, and anastomosed a vein from the leg. Anastomose, I used this yesterday and today, means to attach, anastomosis. But I'm not going to add that. We'll add that next week, anastomosis. Okay, we've got enough on our plate right now. Okie dokie, how are we with our words? Any questions on our words? Any questions? Not too bad, right? We can get it. Remember how I said I'm going to test you, right? One column's going to be what? All your words. The second column is going to be what? All the definitions in the alphabet. Good thing I haven't gone over the alphabet because we've got 26 letters. I've got 22. We've got 22 words, so. Okay. All right. Perfect. Excellent.
So
let's.
I'm sorry.
Yes, Sue.
Dry shirt, sore, that means.
A sore? Do what?
A bedding sore?
A bed sore. Yeah. Okay, pressure sore or bed sore? Or bed sore. Pressure sore or bed sore? When you say I have a sore, what do you think about? What goes through your mind when you say I have a sore? Something that's not healing, or maybe it's a draining, right? You have to keep it covered, put the antibiotic on it. It's a sore. Okay. Very cool. All right, let's go ahead. Let's take a short break. And then we will reconvene. And we will start on some of our nursing assistant skills. Did you guys get a chance to practice your hand washing yesterday?
Yeah, we did.
I know that. Did you practice it at home too?
Mm-hmm.
It's never going to be the same again, is it? We're always going to wash those hands. Okay.
So hold on, it's a break.
Yeah, break.
How long is the break?
Oh, let's till about 9 o'clock. Let's take a short break.